some of the things I know, it is that the Lord wants to remove our eyes on relying on alliances and our own strength. And the Lord wants our eyes to be focused on Him, and we be totally dependent on Him. Hallelujah. And I would like us, we open our Bibles in the book of Isaiah chapter 23. And we read from verses. Let's look at chapter 22, Isaiah chapter 22. And we read from verses 15. Thus says the Lord, God of hosts, go proceed to this steward, to Shebna, who is over the house, and say, what have you here, and whom have you here? That if him a scepter here, as he who heals himself a scepter on high, who carves a tomb for himself in a lock? Indeed, the Lord will throw you away violently, almighty man, and will surely seize you. He will surely turn violently and toss you like a ball into a right country. Then you shall die, and there your glorious chariot shall be the shame of your master's house. So I will drive you out of your office, and from your position he will pull you down. Then it shall be in that day that I will call my servant Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah. I will clothe him with your robe and strengthen him with your belt. I will commit your responsibility into his heart. He shall be a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. The key of the house of David I will lay on his shoulder, so he shall open and no one shall shut, and he shall shut and no one shall open, and I will fasten him as a peg in a secure place, and he will become a glorious throne to his father's house. It will hang on him all the glory of his father's house, the offspring and the posterity, all faces of small quantity, from the cups to all the pitchers. Hallelujah. If you read the preceding chapters to this chapter 22, like in chapter 20, you will see the Lord speaking to Isaiah the prophet. And commanding him, because it's not a request, to uncloth and walk naked for 3 years in Jerusalem. For 3 years. As a symbol. Why? Because of the nations that were surrounding the nation of Israel. They trusted in their own strength. They trusted in the alliances, and the Lord wanted to speak to them by putting Isaiah before them as a symbol. And you know, it was not just to the surrounding nations, but where we have led from, we are seeing one by the name
Shebna. Shebna was the chief administrator of the palace. He was the chief steward. He's the one who was managing the house of the king. And the Lord is speaking to this man who is in charge of the king's house. And the Lord is coming down to depress him, and institute in his position another. Hallelujah. And I want to look at that again, and in particular from let's go back to where we were, and could we look at it in the New Living Translation, if you have it. You have the New Living Translation. Verses 15. Isaiah 22, verses 15. This is what the Lord of heaven's armies, say to me, confront Shebna, the palace administrator, and give him this message. Who do you think you are? And what are you doing here? Building a tomb for yourself and a monument high up in the rock. 17. For the Lord is about to hurl you away. Mighty man is going to grab you, crumple you into a ball, and toss you away into a distant land, barren land. There you will die, and your glorious chariots will be broken and useless. You are a disgrace to your master. Something very key with this man, Shebna. He was supposed to be a pointer to God, and he was supposed to point the people to God. But he used his position to entrench himself and use that authority for his own personal gain. But the Lord is saying, confront Shebna. And it is the Lord speaking this. But also we are seeing, as the Lord says, confront Shebna, the Lord himself is acting on behalf of his people. Hallelujah. Verses 19. Yes, I will drive you out of office, says the Lord. I will pull you down from your high position, and then I will call a servant son. I will call a servant Eliakim, son of Hilkiah, to praise you. And I'm fully persuaded this is a day of divine replacement. Hallelujah. And even though the Lord is speaking to our people and telling them to confront, he is working in partnership with them, and he is the one actually doing it, removing the people who are imposters in places where they are supposed to be, doorways and gateways for kingdom manifestation. Verses 21. I will dress him in your loyal lots and will give him your title and your authority. Two things. There is the dressing that is happening here. And this is not just another kind of dressing. It is the dressing for kingship, for loyalty. And we are seeing the Lord saying, I will dress him in their loyal robe. The second thing is, I will give him your title and your authority. Loyal robe for kingship. A title and a new level of authorization. And it is the Lord who is doing it. And I'll be, and he, now, because of what has happened to Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, the loyal lord, the garment which has been put in him, and this is a dimension of Christ, the loyal lord of kingship, the new title, and the new authorization, this has activated him to become a father to the people of Jerusalem and Judah. Remember, before that, he was not a father. But because of what has happened to him, the loyal lord, the new title, and the new level of organization, he has taken the place of another who was an imposter and has been legitimately been placed there and positioned there by God himself, and he has given him a new name. You shall be a father to the people of Jerusalem and Judah. Hallelujah. 22. I will give him the key to the house of David. And this is where I want to go deeper. But we will see how to go about this. I will give him the key to the house of David. This is Eliakim. This is the man who has been crowned by God with a new robe of kingship. Why? Because the Lord wants to exercise his government. And we are seeing this man is given the key to the house of David, the highest position in the loyal court. So he's given the highest position in the loyal court. When he opens doors, no one will be able to cross them. When he crosses doors, no one will be able to open them. Let's move to 23. I will bring him honor. He will bring honor to his family name. Why? Because sons are builders of their father's house. Sons are builders of their father's name. This man, out of what he will do, will bring honor to his father's name, for I will drive him firmly in place like a nail in the wall. And be sure of this. When the Lord fastens a nail and he says, I will fasten him or drive him firmly, and a picture is painted like a nail in the wall. 24. They will give him great responsibility, and he will bring honor to even the lowest member of his family. Hallelujah. Back to verses 23. Because there is 22. Let's go back to 22. I will give him the key to the house of David, the highest position in the loyal court. He's in the loyal court because he has been activated. He has been stirred up. The impartation dispensation of grace on anointing that has come upon him is enabling him to operate in the kingly dimension. And we are seeing all that. But what I want us to go deeper in is what we are seeing there. I will give him the key to the house of David. And don't remove yourself from this. And the question I want us to ask ourselves, who is David? Who is David? Because we know by then David is not alive. But we are seeing a man who has been given the keys or the key of David. The question is, who is David? Who is David? Let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 19 and we read from verses 18. 2 Samuel verses 19 from verses 18. So David fled and escaped and went to Samuel at Lama. 1 Samuel chapter 19, verses 18 to 24. So David fled and escaped and went to Samuel at Lama and told him all that Saul had done to him. And he and Samuel went and stayed in Naioth. Now it was told Saul, saying, take note, David is at Naioth in Lama. Then Samuel sent messengers to David to take David. And when they saw the group of prophets prophesying and Samuel standing as leader over them, the Spirit of God came upon the messengers of Saul, and they also prophesied. And when Saul was told, he sent other messengers, and they prophesied likewise. Then Saul sent messengers again at that time, and they prophesied also. Then he also went to Ramah and came to the great well that is at Cheshu. So he asked and said, where are Samuel and David? And someone said, indeed, they are at Naioth in Lama. So he went there to Naioth in Lama. Then the Spirit of God was upon him also. And he went on and prophesied until he came to Naioth in Lama. And he also stripped off his clothes and prophesied before Samuel in like manner. And they lay down naked all that day and all that night. Therefore they say, is Saul also a man, the prophet? Let me combine the question I've asked you, David, and the company of prophets. But for the sake of contextualization, allow me to put it this way. David and the apostolic prophetic company. Are we together in that? David and the prophetic apostolic company. Because we are seeing here, and we'll come to where we were in the book of Isaiah. We are seeing here a man called Samuel, a company of prophets, and we are seeing Saul, the king, and David. How many leaders are here? That is Samuel there is Saul, and there is David, and there is the company of prophets. There is the company of the prophetic apostolic. Now, Saul is after David. David flees to where Samuel is. And David finds security in where Samuel is. Saul hears where David is and sends messengers to go and capture David. But when they came within the environment of where the prophetic company were gathered, they also began to prophesy. When they came within the matron of where the prophetic company was, they also began to prophesy. And we saw that Saul sent three bags of messengers at different times. Then he went, he himself. And when he came near, he began to prophesy. And something very unique, I'm seeing in verses 24, he also stripped off his clothes and prophesied before Samuel in like manner and lay down naked all that day and all that night. Therefore they say, is Saul also among the prophets? The question I'm asking myself, the question we are asking ourselves, in all this alleged, who is David? Why is David so key and so important? And that is what I want us to uncover today, because that is where we have allied in. So David, the whole point of having a prophetic apostolic formation is to get to this person called David. I want to repeat that statement. The whole point of having a prophetic apostolic formation is to get to this person called David. If we prophesy, if we are hearing the Lord and prophesying, and we learn to transition and alive at this person called David, we have left unfinished business. And we must do the will of him who has called us and finish his work. So David is more than an individual. He is an icon in the word of God. David is more than an individual. So here we are not just looking at an individual, we are looking at an icon in the word of God. In the modern day language, if you are using a computer and you double click an icon, it opens a whole new world for you. So David is an icon in the word of God. So as we double click David, a whole new world is being opened to us by God. Hallelujah. David is referred to more than 1,000 times in the Bible. He's referred to more than 1,000 times in the Bible, beginning with his appearance as a young shepherd and going all the way down to the book of Revelation. He's mentioned more than 1,000 times. So this is not just an individual. He embodies something more greater than his name, and we'll see that. When we look at the references of David, see is the references we have is what we have learned in verses 22 of Isaiah chapter 22, where we see the key of David. The key of David. The key of David. When you give him the key of David, you give him the ability to govern, the ability to rule, the ability to open the heavens, the ability to open the spiritual world, the ability to determine how things will be in the earth. Why? Because you have the key of David. And we'll go into the depth of that. The key of David, the ability to shut the heavens, the ability to open the heavens, the ability to open territories, and the ability to cross territories. The key of David is one of the reference we see in the Bible. Yeah, the reference we see is the heart of David. The heart of David. And you see, what we are looking at here is who we are as a company. And this is the reality we must manifest in the earth in this generation. The heart of David. How did God guide David? When Saul disobeyed, and Samuel was pleading for him, the Lord spoke to Samuel and told him, I have found a man with my heart. Mark those words. I have found a man who has my heart in the air. This means coming near to David, you're coming near to the heartbeat of God in the earth. Coming near David, you're coming near to the heartbeat, to the resonance, to the sound of the heart of God. And you know where the sound of the heart of God is released? Within the sound, there is the voice of God, and within the voice of God, there is the proceeding one. A man after my own heart. The heart of David. The heart of David. And the reference we see is the throne of David. And we know David was a king. Is that not so? Was Jesus the son of David? Was he the king of kings? So David functioned as a king. But another question is, was David a priest? Yeah? Another question is, was David a prophet? The throne of David. Why? Because he was a king. And we also know that Jesus was called the Son of David. So looking at David, we are not just looking at an individual. It is an icon that we are decoding, so that we can become partakers of the heritage that is in the name David, because we belong to that family tree. And there is a great heritage in that name. We also see in the Bible, mighty men of David. Mighty men of David. And there are Psalms that are referred as the Psalms of David. ETC. You can continue finding it, searching the scriptures. You see, by looking at this icon called David, one thing we are seeing, and we need to understand this, that what God is looking for is a heart that is totally dependent on Him. God is not looking for power. Let me repeat that. God is not looking for power. He is looking for obedience. And I want you to reflect back how God identified David. When Samuel was sent in Jesse's house, and the sons of Jesse were lined up, Samuel even thought the firstborn is the one who has been set apart by God to be the king of Israel. But after going through all of them, and our sister Beatrice reminded us, we need to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit, and we need at all times to be led of the Spirit, because God told Samuel, I don't look the way people look. I look at the heart. I look at the heart. And Samuel asked, don't you have another son? Then the father said, there is one. And it was with the father's sheep. But Samuel said, we cannot rest, we cannot sit down, we cannot eat until David arrives. So David was not a powerful man. David was not a man who was full of authority. David was not a man who had a lot of abilities. Why? Because all those things are given by God. That is not what he's looking for in the earth. By the way, he's not looking for a powerful prophet or a prophetess. No! He's not looking for a powerful minister. No! He's looking for a heart. And when he finds the heart, he partners with that person and endows that person with power and authority to execute his will and purpose in the earth. Hallelujah. Number two, let's look a bit at David's mighty men. We've seen that. There are men who are referred as the mighty men of David. Can we go a bit into the depths of that? Into the depths of that, the mighty men of David. Mighty men of David represents leadership, instructions of authority, equipping, empowering, and mutuality. I will rephrase that this. Anything spiritual the Lord does in the earth, there is always the spiritual substructure. Unapoona mjengo, when you see a tall building, a ministerial building, that is what is holding that building in its foundation. That is what I call the substructure. Anything that you see externally, the Lord doing, that is spiritual and has a stable and external manifestation, that is always a spiritual substructure. And this is that important, that many times when people are hearing God, when people are prophetic, what is expected of them? It is for them to hear God and tell people what God is saying. Hear God and tell people what God is saying. Hear God and tell people what God is saying. But within that, there must be hearing God and what God is saying. And I take these to be like the two level lines. One is hearing God. The other level line is the spiritual substructure, the principles that are hidden within the formation of those people that is giving an external stable spiritual manifestation. Let me come again in that. For you to see a train, that is the spiritual manifestation, there must be two level lines. One is what the Lord has spoken. Second, the level line is the eternal spiritual laws and principles that govern what the Lord has spoken. Are you hearing me? When this one line lacks, are people who are hearing God, many times they go into the spirit world and you can't convince them otherwise, even when they are hearing from very straight spirit, they still believe the one speaking to them is the Spirit of God. And you know, some of the most difficult people to deal with are people who claim to hear God and that the Lord has told them to do this and that. When you tell them this is not of God, they will cut themselves off from you. But I want us to know, anything that is spiritual has internal laws and principles, has internal spiritual laws and principles that bring forth an external manifestation that is stable and predictable. How come some of the most unpredictable people are spiritual people and prophetic people at that? And this is why it is very hard to exercise spiritual government if you don't understand the spiritual substructure of the spiritual laws and principles that govern kingdom of operations. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So the mighty men of David represent leadership. They represent structures of authority. Because they were men of rank. And how did they come to David? They were spiritual men. They discerned where the future of the nation is. And they came to David and told him, you are born of our bones. Or we are born of your bones. And we are fresh of your flesh. And we have a part in you, O son of Jesse. That which you're carrying is not for David the individual. That which you're carrying is a heritage for the entire nation. Hallelujah. And in this we see equipping. I like the first category of men who went to David. These were men who were indebted. They had debts. They were needy. But David equipped these people. In other words, he released the deposit in him. is not built like the kingdoms of this earth. Weak men, the destitute, the hopeless, when they came to David, David imparted grace upon them. In other words, David impacted the economy of heaven on them. That divine resource transformed these men, and they became the mighty men of David. And in this there is mutuality. Mutuality means, or being mutual means, each other part within that relationship is contributing. Because in the kingdom of God, being a parasite is not allowed. It's not allowed. It can't be that you're the only one who receives. Then every soul, there is something very wrong within your construct. The internal spiritual principles and laws that has formed your inner man, they need to be restructured. They need to be reorganized. And you need to be reactivated again so that as you receive, you also give.
Hallelujah.
We are not consumers. We are distributors. We are manufacturers. And God has built capacity in us to feed the whole world. We see that in David. And this man honored and respected rank. They were men of the spirit. They were able to discern David. And you know, some of them, this is the most amazing thing, some of the mighty men of David had done greater and mightier deeds than David. Let me tell you, authority is not discovered. Authority is discerned. And you see, when you understand where authority is, even when you are a man of authority, you know how to submit within the ranks. Because God is not a God of disorder.
Hallelujah.
And this far, what we know in this city, and especially where people are craving, the spirit is moving, what we have seen is confusion and chaos. But our God is a God of order.
Hallelujah.
And he is not the author of confusion. And let me tell you this, any gifting, any charisma that operates without government is fueled by the spirit of Jezebel. And Jezebel sits right next to the throne to control and manipulate the throne. And in this city, we have many people operating with charisma and gifting, but they have very little regard for government. Let me tell you in this, as you begin and as you build momentum, it might look like you are the woman or the man of the hour. But when the things gains momentum, every man and woman in that ministry is converted into a eunuch. So there is no mutual exchange. It is a one-man show, which builds a personality cult. People gather not in the presence of God, but they gather around gifting of a man or a woman. And any man or woman of God hearing me, this should put some sense in us. And what we require is not power.
Woo!
submission to divine authority. Hallelujah. And you know, when you submit, you're secure. You're safe. By the way, when you submit, you come under authority. And you palate under delegated authority. Therefore, you become a powerful man, a woman of God. Because you're palating in the ways of another. So the Psalms of David, the spirit of worship, and the songs that we sing. So David was not just a king, he was a worshiper. And I normally say, if Solomon, the son of David, who is an apostolic figure, an apostolic type of a leader, is a prototype of an apostolic leader and an apostolic king. If he had just a drop of the sensitivity that his father had to the Spirit of God, he would have emerged as one of the most powerful, stable king whoever ever lived in the earth. Sensitivity to the Spirit. David is a man who was very sensitive to the Spirit of God. He was able to capture the vibes, frequency of the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. And then sing to God. David was a worshiper. He was a guitar man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you see, one of the things I know with music and worship, you can't get depressed if you're a worshiper. Because even when you feel down and you begin amplifying the name of the Lord from your spirit man, you're replenished by the Spirit of grace. And you know, one of the ingredients within the Spirit of grace is a growth hormone. Let me repeat that. One of the ingredients within the Spirit of grace is a growth hormone. Therefore, as you worship, and there is the impartation of grace, and your spirit man is stirred up, you come out of that a better person. And when you come to the gathering of the saints, you are carrying, thus says the Lord. Hallelujah. So wherever you go, whomever you meet with, you become a son of encouragement. You know, there are brothers and sisters who are very negative. You know what? When you meet with them, at times you don't know because you're innocent. But when you leave them, you feel demoralized. You feel value has been removed from you. You feel abused. But there are people, when you gather around them, you feel good. Hallelujah. You don't feel like going. You feel your self-worth. Why? Because this is a person who is a worshiper and lives, or she lives, before God. Therefore, when you meet, value is added to you. And that should be our position. That whenever we meet with our brothers and sisters, we should always add value to them. Because value has been added to us. But we must be worshippers. And you see, what amazes me with God, that there is one category of people he is searching for and seeking for. Those who worship him in truth and in spirit. And you know, it's a big shame that the Pentecostal charismatic leadership has gone back to the hangovers of the dark ages. That instead of maturing
as sons of God and fully demonstrate the Melchizedek order of life and ministry, they go back to ritualistic cords of life and ministry that is very fallen to the kingdom of God. Because in our fullness, and that fullness has come, it is for us to be kings and priests unto our God, so that we as a company can impact the structures and the systems that govern human life in the earth. We are the kings in this land, and we don't have to affiliate or associate ourselves with any political figures. But we are the determining force, because we carry the authority of the Most High. And just like double creaking David, you double creak the kingdom of God. It should be with every son of God. And when people double creak you and you are activated, what comes forth is the greatness and the fastness of the kingdom of God. Because we belong to a different order. And let me tell you, and I want you to hear me, you should refuse to be called a religious leader. We are spiritual leaders. We are spiritual leaders. And we are born by the Spirit of God. We are sons of His birthing. And your authority and power has been delegated on us. And we have the ability and the capacity to shift things in the Spirit and to other things on the face of the earth. We are of a different kind. We carry the Spirit of God. We carry the Spirit of the Sovereign One. He's above all. He is sovereign. And we are His sons. And like the pattern son was the accurate representation of the invisible Father in the visible realm, so are we. As He is in heaven, so are we in the earth. Because our hearts are connected with His heart, and we carry the heartbeat of God. What is moving us, what activates us into action, is the impartation of divine frequency of the heartbeat of God, and our hearts are resonating with the same sound as the heart of the Father in heaven. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In this hour, it is not possible to demonstrate that reality if you don't have the heart of David. No, worship is not a song. You don't become a worshiper because you're a worship leader. Worship is a lifestyle. And it comes to you because you have the revelation of the Father. When the Father reveals Himself to you, that word becomes inside of you. It becomes a lifestyle. Therefore, your lifestyle is one given in reference to God. And wherever you go, you are the carrier of His presence. You don't need to tell people I am a man of God. You don't need to tell people I am a woman of God. You carry the aura of His presence wherever you go. And where you go, wherever you go, the environment changes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That becomes your security. You know, many men and women of God think as you grow up, you become more carnal. That you have bouncers, huge men who are having biceps. The security of a man of God is in the presence of Jehovah. And you try to do like this, that heart will remain like that. Until it is ordered otherwise by the man of God. So we are not operating from a place of insecurity. We are secure.
Hallelujah.
Because we are a David company.
Yeah.
We don't just hear him. And we don't just speak his mind. We've also been authorized to exercise government. Therefore we are highly governmental. And we have the spiritual authority to shift environment. And this is why, to our brothers and sisters who activated in the area of music, songs, today we will have an impartation of grace, so that your heart or your spirit man can be fully activated and you be joined with this prophetic apostolic company. So that wherever you are, as you offer your service, you're doing it under authority. Because I normally say, some of the people who are very near to Lucifer, Satan, are music ministers. And many of them don't know protocol, spiritual protocol. They don't know rank and government. And you know, when you brought into the limelight, and in the process of your making as a leader, you sidestepped and you stepped some of the faces of your making. When you come to the limelight, the uncovered element within you will bring you down. Because when you come to the limelight, you become an attractor core. You attract God and you attract all kinds of people and all kinds of devils. And many times, the devils that come near you are not black with two horns. They are coming in white robes. They come as angels of light. If you never developed your inner gadget properly, so that you have spiritual insight and discernment, when they are praising you that you are a man or a woman of God, you don't know you're on your way down, because they have waylaid you. You know, the security of a man or a woman of God is in spiritual insight and discernment. Remember when Paul went to Philippi with Silas, and a girl came prophesying by the spirit of divination. These are the servants of the Most High God. You know, to many of us, we would rejoice. Why? Because many of us are false prophets. And I normally say, when you hear the word many, it is more than half. More than half of the preachers, you know, they are false. Their God is their belly. So this girl is saying, these are the servants of the Most High God. Paul silenced her. That got them into trouble. But even trouble, they didn't begin blaming each other when they were in prison. In the thick of it, in the midst of darkness at midnight, as they were praising God, the heavens shook the earth, and the gates and the chains and the doors of prison were opened up. And they told their chief jailer, "No, hold your peace. We are not running away." And the first thing he said, "At night, what can I do?" And the man was baptized with his whole family. You must be men and women of the Spirit. I must be a man of the Spirit. And now, men and women of the Spirit, most of the times, get into trouble. Especially with the religious class. Because they hate the Spirit of Christ. And you need to understand, in many pulpits today, the spirit operating there is the spirit of Antichrist. They hate the revelation of Christ because they are operating out of order. And their God is their belly. There must be a people with a difference. Because this is a new day. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's a new day. So new songs must come forth out of what the Spirit of the Lord is speaking today. We need fresh songs. Yes. Songs that are relevant in line with the season we are in. Hallelujah. And we must check the content within the songs. They must sing Christ and the revelation of Christ. So what is David? What is David? David, one, is a company of people committed to total obedience. So we say David is not an individual. David is an icon. So what is David? David is a company of people committed to total obedience. David is a company of people committed to total obedience. And we must understand this one thing. Obedience is a matter of the heart. So God is looking for a heart. Cooperate. God is looking for a heart. I want to lead a word in Acts chapter 13 and verses 22. Acts 13, 22. Acts 13, 22. And when he had removed him, he raised up for them David as king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, "I have found David, the son of Jesse." It is God who is saying that. "I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, who will do all I will." Total obedience. He's a man, or a corporate man who lives under a command. You know, many of us seek authorization. But we must understand authorization operates under a command. When you're working under a command, this is what happens. A command is a word that has proceeded from authority. In matters kingdom, a command is a divine word that has come from the throne of God. That word is what in Hebrew they called Dabar. Dabar is a word by itself, it is pregnant with purpose and destiny. It has all it needs for it to come to pass. When the divine word of the Lord becomes incarnate in you, and you have a grace impartation, and your spirit man is stirred up by the Spirit of God, there is nothing as dangerous as a being like that in the earth. And you know, you're called a man of God or a woman of God because of this one thing. When people hear you speak, they hear God. It is not the titles. It is not the positions. It is because you live and walk in the authority of the proceeding word. And I had said, God is not looking for power. He's all powerful. He's looking for obedience. The other thing is, number two, a faithful steward who builds foundations for future success through progressive process. And it all began when he was called as a shepherd. So David, and this must be found in us, is a faithful steward who builds foundations for future success through progressive process. You know the word foundation, which is tithemi. It's that which has been made, that which has been laid down, that which, what is being built, or what is intended to come forth, proceeds from there. And I want to connect this with a very key principle in the kingdom of God. Issues of fatherling and sonship. And this must get very clear in our hearts. That in the kingdom of God, God doesn't have members. And in the kingdom of God, you don't join to become. In the kingdom of God, God has only one component called sons. And in the kingdom, you are born. And you're not just born anyhow. You are born by the Spirit of the Father. Hallelujah. And Jesus was not a Christian. Woo! Christianity is a religious. Religion. Jesus did not come to begin a religion called Christians. Hallelujah. Christianity. Hallelujah. And this tells you, when you ask me my religion, I'll tell you none. I'm not a religious figure. The Father came with this one mission and this one purpose. He sent his only begotten Son with this one mission. That in him, the Son, the Father will be reconciling the lost sons with himself in the Son. And he has given us the ministry of reconciliation. We are sons of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, membership is, those are statistics. You must refuse just to become a mathematical figure. And you are very proud because you are member number two. In the archives, you are a founding member. And you know, people fight for what belongs to them. And let me tell you, the fight and the strife you see
among his church leaders can simply tell you the anointing has lifted away. People don't fight over the anointing. They don't. People fight over property. And let me tell you, if you're operating from where the Father operates, you can lose everything. But because you have the power to create, you will create it more better. You will create better things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They demand you to give them their car. Give them. It's an old model. You get the latest model with the latest engine. A car that detects that there is another car before you, so it stops without you stopping it. It's even mindful of your security. It knows who it is carrying. So if they demand for it, let it go. If you, even as yet you don't have the muscles to create, we are receiving the spirit of adoption as sons. Call this corporate company. And before we leave your locality, we'll have created in abundance, in excess, much more than what you require. This means one of the virtues that must be with each one of us is generosity. Generosity. Hallelujah. When the Father releases truth from heaven and it comes in form of revelation knowledge, there must be fathers in the earth who will capture that, preserve that, transmit that to the next generation of sons without diluting it. That is how you preserve a move of God. You men and women of God who are hearing me, you know those who have gone before us, they are finishing weak and very poorly. We were ordained to finish strong and with exactness. When Moses finished building the Ark of the Covenant, and in actuality, it is not Moses who built it. The work of Moses was to give it spiritual superintendent. The man who built it is a Bezalel and company. For them to build with exactness, they had to receive the spirit of wisdom and understanding. And when it was finished, because it was built according to the pattern, Moses was shown on the mountain. At the end of the process, God embedded his signature upon it by causing his glory to come down and fill that house. None of us who is healing me was ordained to finish weak, because when the word of the Lord goes forth, it calls everything in order and aligns everything with the proceeding word, so that all of us as a company can walk in total submission and obedience to the command of the Lord. And one thing I love and I like about Christ, and he should never allow nobody, even yourself, to take away the liberty that you have in Christ. Because when that liberty and freedom is taken away, your ears begin to become dull. You're no longer functioning according to the preceding word. You're functioning according to the rules and regulations of men. And especially when you begin to climb up the hierarchy of religious orders. And there is nowhere in the Bible We see somebody being called into the office of the light levered. And you know, some of us think that we are respectful when you call somebody levered. That's false humility. It's false humility. Then after that, you become bishop. After that, you become archbishop. And very soon, we are going to have Pentecostal popes. And what we see today in the bishopric order is very different with the bishopric order in the New Testament. Because I'm not saying that the office of the bishop is not there. But the office of bishop we see today and that which is in the New Testament are two worlds apart. And that's for another day. That's for another day. So the bad thing is, when you mention David, David is a divine initiative in the end times. David is a divine initiative in their times. Amos 9:11. Amos 9:11. And before we go there, every golden calf system of worship that is put in praise by men is not put in praise by boys. I want you to look up, because I want you to let go this in your spirit man. Every golden calf system of worship is not installed or instituted by boys. It is instituted by men who are initially called by God. They were made partakers of the divine nature, but along the way, they deviated. And they want to preserve their name and their kingdom. That's for another day. You know, you know where we are. What is happening today cannot be dealt with by boys. What has been instituted by men must be deconstructed by men. When Joshua cast the waters of Jericho and the land was fertile, it called a man of a higher order to undo that by just one decree. You know, many of us are fighting battles we don't understand. The spirit of revelation of Christ is back in the church, and what we are building in the hearts of the saints is understanding, because if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? And you know, at times people say, those things are hard. Grow up. Mature up. Hello? Mature? Because we're only having one menu. One item in our menu. There are no options in the menu we've been given. That menu has only one thing. My meat is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. And let me tell you, we are not leaving any unfinished business. Even with that which was left unfinished, we have grace and anointing. And for your information, the dimension of grace
that the Lord has also released in this hour has a Jehu anointing. That's for another day. So a divine initiative in their times. Amos 9:11. On that day I will raise up the tower which has fallen down and repair its damages. I will raise up its ruins and rebuild it as in the days of old. Let me ask you a question. Who is saying on that day I will raise up the tabernacle of David which has fallen down? Is it not the Lord God? So we are seeing David being mentioned here, the tabernacle of David. So we are seeing this as a divine initiative in the last days. Connecting this with number 4 is the capacity to receive insight and decode revelation about ultimate events. Let me come slowly. The ability, the capacity to receive insight and insight and decode revelation about ultimate events. And you can see that in Revelation chapter 5 and verses 4. And I want to connect that with, there are some kings in Israel who are not direct sons of David. They were not biological sons of David. Somebody like is it Zedekiah? Somebody like Josiah? Josiah is a boy of 8 years. Yet the Bible records, and he walked according to the ways of the heart of his father David. You know, for you to do this, it's like somebody who had walked along the beach where there is sand, along the beach, and he has left footsteps along the shores of the beach where there is sand. Then a tide comes and covers that. And somebody comes years later and is able to perceive and discern there were pathways which were created here. And this is not something you can do more or less with how you see us taking photos. You must have this inner spiritual formation that has the ability to scan. You know, it amazes me when you go through a scanning machine, it doesn't show your flesh, your meat. It shows your bone structure. So if somebody is walking like this, the flesh is okay. What you need to recollect is the bone structure, because that person is having scoliosis. And you know, somebody said, if your head and your body are not in line, they are disjointed, like the way a car behaves when the center board is broken like this. They normally say you're taken through a process of realigning your head with your body without anesthesia. And it's one of the most painful processes, because they take your body to. And many of us are functioning
out of joint with the head, which is Christ. Hallelujah. And we must be men and women such that when you encounter with a woman or a man of God and they're having issues in ministry, you don't hear what they're saying, but you're able to hear the voice in the voice and know the problem in the life of this dynamic and powerful minister is not the flesh, but the bone structure, the foundations. This is one of the dimensions which is activated in us as I talk. The ability to have insight. That insight gives you the capacity and the ability to decode spiritual revelation so that you are able to declare things with clarity because you are seeing it the way the Lord is seeing it. Therefore, you become the mouthpiece of the Lord in the earth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So this dimension, the Davidic dimension, has the capacity to receive insight and decode revelation about ultimate things. And I want to live there. Could we go to Revelation 5 from verse 1? And I saw in the light heart of him who sat on the throne a scroll written inside on the back, sealed with seven seals. So this scroll, something was written on it, but it was sealed with seven seals. So it's something written. It has a lot of information. It has a lot of knowledge, but it is coded. Even if you open it, you can't understand it. Unless the seal is broken. Verses 2. Then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals? 3. And one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look at it. So I wept much because no one was found worthy to open and leave a scroll or to look at it. But one of the elders said to me, do not weep. Behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, mark that, the root of David has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its seal. You can read the list for yourself because these are scriptures. But I want you to know this as it is in Jeremiah 3 verses 15. The Lord himself in this hour and this season is giving forth shepherds who are doing everything according to his will, and they are feeding the flock with knowledge and understanding. And two dimensions that are primarily sources with prophets and apostles. And if somebody calls himself an apostle or a prophet and lack this, beware of them. Because many of us are apostles by lumas. Somebody had lumas, passed the lumas to another. Because two primary resources that are a dimension of Christ is the spirit of wisdom and the spirit of revelation. Those two. And these are the two greatest investments that are downloaded in the earth to our people for the building process. And I want you to check, every prophet in the Old Testament was a builder. This means all of us must be redefined by the reconstituting of our inner formation and whatever kind of ministry we are doing, we must be building. Hallelujah. And the seals are being broken. You know, at times when you hear the revelation of Christ, it is way beyond your mind, because revelation is not something you can cook in your mind. Logic you can cook. Reason you can cook. But revelation you can't, because it is something given by the Spirit of God. And the next phase we are moving to is the battles between the sons of Greece and the sons of Zion. Because the sons of Greece come with the sons of Zion come with the revelation of Christ. And we have already won the battle even before we arrive there. Hallelujah. Because he said, I will build my church and the gates of hell. Put that in the message fashion. Is it Matthew 16, 18? Message fashion, I like it that way. Matthew 16, 18. Because fear is not part of our package. And now I am going to tell you. And now I'm going to tell you who you are. Really, when somebody tells you, I will tell you who you are, and tell you who you are, really, it's something bit deeper. You are Peter. You are a rock. You are a Petros. There is the small pebble called Petros, which has come from the big log, which is called Petras. So they call you Simon, but that is according to the environment you are born and raised in. But according to divine destiny, the way you are ordained before time, you are ordained to be the small log, which has come from the big log. So the church is not built on the man Peter. The church is built on the revelation of Christ. And the church is the house of the Father. The oikos of the Father is built by the revelation of sonship. So the house that where the Father dwells in the earth is called Son. Let me repeat that. The house where the Father dwells, the carrier of the Father in the earth, the carrier of the presence of the Father is a house, oikos, called Son. For you to build the house of the Father must give you the revelation of sonship. So you walk with this consciousness. And this is the highest status you can be given of son. Because son has the right to inherit the Father. Son can exercise the government of the Father. The Son can rule and govern on behalf of the Father. And now I am going to tell you who you are.
your Peter a log. This is the log on which I will put together my oikos, my house, my dwelling, my executive, my senate. And this formation called church will be so expansive with energy that don't even the gates of hell will be able to keep it out. A church so expansive with energy. That's who we are. And we are not weaklings. And they better hear, those who have been luring and governing, and they are not legitimate. They better know we have come of age. And there is nothing we are leaving undone. There is nothing we are leaving behind. We are not even leaving the hooves behind. We are carrying everything because it's ours. And in the interest of time, let me put a poster. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you. Amen.